Discoveries in science these days come at breakneck speed, so much so it's difficult to keep up. Exciting times indeed as our knowledge base of the universe expands, so here are 10 recent scientific discoveries that struck me as unusual and interesting. Number 10. The Zodiacal Light and Mars. Occasionally, and I've seen this myself several times, while watching the night sky, a faint glow can be seen. Often cone-shaped and brighter near to the sun, it's often called the false dawn or zodiacal light. Even fainter, it can sometimes be spotted stretching across the ecliptic or the plane of the solar system as a band. A related phenomenon is known as the gegenschein, and is due to a similar situation where you see a backscatter of sunlight from dust directly opposite of the sun as a faint oval glow in the sky. Both of these are phenomena of dust in the solar system, a sort of pancake-shaped disk of diffuse dust that scatters light. It was always assumed that this dust's origins were comets and asteroids, but this began to change with a strange phenomenon picked up by the Juno spacecraft. Juno's cameras started picking up tiny bits of debris. It was soon realized that the spacecraft's huge solar panels were being impacted by dust, the same dust responsible for the zodiacal and related light phenomena. As a result, Juno became a dust detector, something its original mission hadn't anticipated, other than to build the solar panels strong enough to handle such a situation. It was found that the dust extends from the orbit of Earth to the orbit of Jupiter, and along with other data from other spacecraft, seems to point to an origin not of comets and asteroids, but Mars. Modeling of the orbit of the dust again suggests a Mars link, though it's not hard to imagine that comets and asteroids may still be contributing. But the problem is, no one knows how dust particles from an entire planet, Mars, could end up in space in such concentrations and distributions. Number 9. More information on the TRAPPIST-1 system. In 2016, a group of planets was found orbiting a red dwarf known as TRAPPIST-1, located only about 40 light years away. This system, which is significantly older than our solar system, consists of a system of 7 known planets, 4 of which are within the habitable zone of the star. Very little else is known. However, the launch and commencement of operations of the James Webb Space Telescope has started delivering preliminary science on these planets. This observation in particular focuses on TRAPPIST-1b, the closest planet in to the star, and not within the habitable zone. But it was low-hanging fruit as far as trying to characterize its atmosphere, so they searched just before and just after the planet passed behind the TRAPPIST star in order to see how heat was affecting the planet's surface. The previous idea was that despite being in a hot zone, TRAPPIST-1b might have a thick atmosphere, circulating the heat around the planet. This should have returned a dim signal, but it ended up far brighter than expected. In short, this planet has no atmosphere at all. The surface of the day side of the planet is a sweltering 230 degrees Celsius, 446 Fahrenheit, and likely the planet lost its atmosphere shortly after its formation, or during a subsequent violent solar flare. This particular planet is not thought to be a candidate for life in the system, only those further out. But it was a win in that JWST can characterize the conditions of exoplanets under the right circumstances. More work is needed, however, for the other members of the system. Number 8. Quantum physics and Titan life. Our solar system is interesting in that surface liquids are rare. Subsurface liquid probably occurs in a number of solar system objects, but actual surface liquid is almost unique to Earth, certainly liquid water is. But there's one other small moon of Saturn that does have liquid, but there, water is basically a rock. It's Titan, and on its surface we've seen hydrocarbon lakes existing in liquid form at extremely frigid temperatures. This has led to an open question. Could such a place see biotic or prebiotic chemistry happening in those liquids? At first glance, the answer was probably no. It's too cold for the chemistry needed for it to happen, so far as we know. But it has been floated that maybe there is a way past that, and that some kinds of chemical reactions might occur, albeit very slowly. One recent discovery is that any such chemistry and resultant life may actually be able to react not through standard chemistry, but due to a quantum effect. The problem is that for reactions to occur, energy is needed. The lower the temperature, the less energy. But if particles could quantum tunnel, which is a known and proven quantum effect, then some type of chemistry might occur through this alternative means. This opens the way for thought on the subject of quantum life and quantum chemistry. If it can ever be shown that this occurs on Titan, then it very likely occurs throughout the universe under those conditions. Number 7. The Return of the Giant Lacewing. The existence of a species is very situational. Natural selection and evolution provides for organisms to find niches that they adapt to. But if that niche alters or goes away, extinction usually comes. Sometimes, however, that can be misleading. There have been several incidents where animals once thought to have been extinct resurfaced. In other cases, the niches shift, and so does the population, and that appears to be what happened with an insect known as the giant lacewing. The giant lacewing wasn't extinct. It had simply abandoned part of its former range in North America for reasons unknown, starting in the 19th century. That was until 2012 when an insect specialist spotted something out of place clinging to the exterior wall of a Walmart in Arkansas. The specimen was collected, taken shopping in the Walmart, preserved, and then forgotten about until recently. Turns out it was a giant lacewing outside of its current range, suggesting that it and other insects might actually remain in their former habitats and pockets, micro niches as it were. Walmart apparently being one for the giant lacewing. Number 6. Black holes and dark energy. Few things are as mysterious in the universe as black holes, but one candidate is dark energy, the mysterious energy that drives the accelerating expansion of the universe. But as it turns out, the two may be linked. This is strange stuff. Conventional wisdom would tend to be that gravity should cause the universe to contract. It is, after all, an attractive force. Black holes take gravity to another level, possessing so much mass that light itself can't escape them. As it turns out, studies of black holes at the centers of galaxies that have stopped accreting material, and thus should have stopped growing, apparently didn't. Further, they did it at a rate that can't be fully accounted for by absorbing material or colliding with other galaxies. Models showed, however, that if you factor in the expansion of the universe into this increase, it fits, meaning that dark energy is somehow hiding inside black holes and having an effect on the overall expansion of the universe. This involves one interpretation of general relativity, where virtual particles popping in and out of existence create a kind of vacuum energy. This may explain a huge mystery regarding black holes. What lies at their heart? This has always been theorized to be a singularity, but actually it may simply be dark energy, and thus there's no need to invoke a singularity, solving a number of questions in physics. Work on this is very early, and it's not clear how to test it, but it might actually be that the dual mysteries of black hole singularities and dark energy might have had a simpler answer than what was initially thought. Or maybe not, since we're dealing with something that in one instance is an attractive force, but in another sense, repels. Number 5. The Impossible Rings of Quasar. Rings around bodies in the solar system are well represented. In addition to Saturn's glorious ring system, they're also found at Jupiter, Uranus, and Neptune. Strangely though, the dwarf planet Quasar also seems to have a ring system. And more, it shouldn't be where it is. This involves something called the Roche limit, which is the point where an object orbiting a larger object gets torn apart and can form a ring. Outside it, everything coalesces and forms a moon or moonlet. In short, Quasar should have a moon where it has a ring because it's well outside the Roche limit. There are other oddities regarding this mostly water ice ring. It's irregular in that some parts can be as much as 100 kilometers wide, but in others just 5 kilometers wide. It's unclear what's causing all this, but one option may be the extremely low temperatures of the outer solar system is somehow preventing the ring from collapsing, or a small moon known to be orbiting in the system might be preventing it. It's probably also the case that the Roche limit is too general and doesn't really account for factors like the composition of the materials involved and others. Even still, for now, Quasar has what we think is an impossible ring. Number 4. Magnetars are getting stranger. Magnetars are a type of isolated neutron star, the collapsed core of a massive star that went supernova, that also sports a very powerful magnetic field, in fact the strongest such fields known. These things are incredibly dense, packing more mass than the Sun into a sphere just 20 kilometers across. The material they are made from is degenerate, the atoms are crushed, and it's been famously said that a teaspoonful would weigh as much as a mountain does here on Earth. But actually describing what this material would be like if you could study it up close has been problematic, because it's been described as a solid, superfluid, fluid, etc. In short, no one really knows how it acts, and it may well be dependent on the local conditions. Until perhaps now. Recent research looking at X-rays emitted by a magnetar found that they actually do seem to have a solid surface of sorts. Extreme gravity seems to force the material into what is called a Bingham plastic, the consistency of which lies somewhere between a solid and a fluid. While not a great analogy, you could envision it as being like a very heavy mayonnaise, due mainly to the presence of the magnetic field. But without a magnetar's magnetic field, this may not happen. But that's not the only strangeness regarding magnetic fields and magnetars. Other research last year was able to track and map to a degree X-ray emitting hotspots on the surface of another magnetar, and they were dynamic, with one spot coalescing with a smaller spot. In short, the mayonnaise may be moving. Number 3. Insights into cave paintings. One thing that fascinates me and fires my imagination are prehistoric cave paintings. They provide one of the few windows we have into the world of our early Homo sapiens ancestors. They are a snapshot of that world, telescoping tens of thousands of years to us today. Messages from our very origins, and in some ways as close to reading the mind of an intelligent alien civilization as you can get, since the world in which they lived is very far removed from our modern world, almost entirely without technology. But one question has always been present. Why paint on cave walls? The answer may be more complicated and spooky than we thought. Evidence found in New Zealand studying ancient tree trunks embedded in wetlands has provided evidence for the date of the so-called Lachamp excursion. This was where the magnetic poles of Earth switched positions briefly about 42,000 years ago. It's possible that this may have caused climate changes and an influx of solar and cosmic radiation that drove humans at the time into caves for protection. More work is needed on this, but other work has shown that we might have been making cave art before this period. The oldest known cave art has recently been discovered in Indonesia and dates to 44,000 years ago. They depict figurative artwork, no less, in that they show part animal figures that have no counterpart in nature, presumably showing that the people that made it had a conception of supernatural beings in some kind of religion. Given that these early paintings show a high level of artistic complexity, it points strongly that there may have been precursor art being made that isn't preserved, so far as we found, going all the way back to humanity's origins in Africa. Oddly, these new paintings would have been discovered long before now, except that they were located 65 feet above the cave floor, and no one had noticed until recently. Number 2. Mars has weird oxygen levels. Mars does some strange things. It's been known for a while that the atmosphere of Mars sports a small amount of methane, but it shouldn't. Methane gets broken down under those conditions, and it's so bad that there should never be any measurable amount present, yet there is. This suggests that there is a mechanism on Mars that's producing methane. There are two possibilities: that it's somehow being produced geologically, or it's being produced biologically. Most of Earth's methane is biological in origin, and with Mars, the methane production seems to bloom, with the Curiosity rover detecting sharp rises in methane that come and go very rapidly. That mystery has deepened. Mars has oxygen, but that's not surprising. There are many oxygen-containing molecules on Mars ranging from water vapor to carbon dioxide, and ultraviolet light breaks that stuff down. The problem is that you should always see about the same levels, but actually we don't. The oxygen production on Mars varies seasonally. You see it rise in spring and then it drops towards winter. Worse, it varies year to year while still following that cycle. Seasonal gases aren't too surprising, however. all sorts of things seasonally change, such as atmospheric pressure, freezing and thawing of carbon dioxide, etc., that can alter the chemistry that's going on. The problem is that Mars' seasonal oxygen variation is too extreme to be explained by that. So there's something else going on that we haven't discovered. One thing has to be noted though, oxygen, like methane, is a biosignature gas. Life is where most of Earth's oxygen comes from. Number 1. Discrepancies against Einstein. It's no secret that we have a poor understanding of gravity. We can describe its behavior on small scales, but on large scales we have to invoke things like dark matter to account for what we see happening with galaxies. The problem is, we have absolutely no idea what dark matter is, and we've never seen any evidence of it outside its gravitational effects. But there's also a minority viewpoint that's growing, that dark matter may not exist, and that our understanding of some parts of physics may be a bit off. Known as modified Newtonian dynamics, or MOND, it's a hypothesis that modifies Newton's laws to account for what we see when we observe galaxies. The interesting thing here is that we may be seeing indicators that MOND may be at least a step in the right direction on rethinking the question of dark matter and gravity at large scales. Science is a process of revision. It changes as new information comes to light, and we might actually be seeing that happen. Astronomers studying star clusters have found what appears to be an unexpected asymmetry in the arrangement of their stars. Star clusters show arrangements of stars in two slightly opposing tails, caused by stars moving and interacting inside the cluster. Under regular Newtonian physics, these tails should be about equal, but they're not. The leading tail pointing towards the center of the galaxy has more stars, which matches the predictions of MOND, which says that this effect should be expected. But much more study of many more clusters is needed to nail down whether this effect is really there, and indicating the validity of MOND, mainly because it would require a major course correction for cosmology. But it wouldn't be the first time that's happened. Thanks for listening. I'm futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, and be sure to check out my books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channels for regular in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.